Hey, it's October 20th, 2015. I'm Reginald, also known as Dimcad. Hey guys, welcome back to the Dimcad channel. First, President Obama is announcing that we're pretty much going to stay in Afghanistan, and that's not really a surprise at all. We currently have about 9,600 soldiers in Afghanistan officially, and we're going to bring that number down to about 5,500 officially sometime in 2016. Looks like we're going to have at least three bases. We're going to have a presence in at least three cities moving forward. I never expected us to fully move out of Afghanistan. It's actually rare for the U.S. to fully move out of any country. They may actually shut down bases, but they'll still have some type of unofficial presence in a country to sort of steer the politics in a certain direction, in hopes that they can control the situation or at least have a significant amount of influence on the situation. And it's really interesting how people just completely, how they just completely disregard everything that was said before an election, and how the voters just let them get away with it too. It's really fascinating. People pretend like they're passionate about this war or stopping the war. In reality, it's all just partisan politics. And even when the person they voted for actually continues a war or escalates a certain war, people just ignore it. They just move on to the next reality TV show, next presidential campaign. It's really fascinating. Speaking of which, Trump actually called Bush out on 9/11, or at least it's interesting to hear anybody, any politician, say anything about 9/11, especially when the politician is a Republican criticizing Bush. He later on said that he wasn't necessarily blaming Bush, but he was saying that essentially 9/11 happened on his watch. And I thought that was really fascinating, because years ago people would have never even thought to even say something like that. It's interesting how people are willing to, well, at least Trump is willing to say things that other people aren't willing to say, and that's his appeal. That's why the guy is doing so well. I mean, that's the secret. The establishment is waiting on this guy to fall apart, and I really didn't think he was serious at first, because for many years he said that he's going to run for president, and he hasn't actually done that. But this year, it looks like he's actually hiring staff. He's doing more than just saying things. He's doing more than just dominating the news coverage. He's actually hiring staff, which is a key indicator that he may actually be serious. There's actually an organization forming here. So that's really fascinating. We'll see what happens there. Jobs. Okay, apparently we created, 120,000 jobs in September, according to the official reports. Although, ZeroHedge.com actually posted an article explaining that we actually had 99,000 jobs produced nationwide, at least when you look at the states, and we actually lost over 120,000 jobs during that same month. So we lost about a net of 22,000 jobs in September. It's really fascinating, especially when you look at how certain states are doing better than others. It's not necessarily a partisan thing. Oh, this state's controlled by Democrats, this state's controlled by Republicans. The biggest job producer by far is actually Texas. By far. I mean, the nearest one, the number two state is actually New York, and they're not even half what Texas was doing as far as creating jobs. And that's absolutely incredible. It says a lot about how a policy and how a way a state is run can really impact the economy. It just shows you there's a big difference there, and it goes beyond partisan politics. You know, the next state was actually Georgia. Well, one was Texas. Texas was at number one, followed by New York, followed by Georgia, followed by California. And then when you look at the worst states, the states were actually losing the most jobs, it was actually Missouri, followed by Pennsylvania, followed by Michigan and Ohio. Really interesting. Sort of a Midwestern type of thing going on there. It's interesting how certain regions struggle. And you guys can dig more into that data and actually check it out. It says a lot. I mean, you need jobs to have any type of help. It starts with jobs. And people don't understand this. People think that, oh, you can create this social program, you can provide these benefits and this. Look, this money has to come from somewhere. You have to start with the jobs, and it's something that people just ignore. But anyway, speaking of states, Michigan, you know, I've been thinking about what it would be like to go back to Michigan. And I don't think I can ever go back to Flint. And it's not really to knock Flint, because, I mean, let's be honest, Flint, Michigan has a lot of problems, to say the least. Crime, the economy, lack of jobs. But there's some good communities in Flint. The thing is, the job situation just makes it impossible for me to ever go home. And it sort of raises an even bigger question. Can you ever really go home again? I have gone home, and every time I go back, it's not really the same. Even when I just go there to visit. You know, I had friends telling me that, oh yeah, Flint's booming. You know, and then I went back around the holidays, and it was pretty dead. You're telling me, oh, it's booming. Really? Okay. I go back and it's the same, you know, same pothole here, same pothole there. You know, it's like the same one, you know. And, you know, I don't see any jobs popping up. And, yeah, it's sad that, you know, certain areas just don't have a resurgence. They don't, they just go down, down, down. They just, it's sad that you can't go back home because there's no jobs there. There's no economy there. And there's good communities in Flint. I know some good people really care about their neighborhood, but there's just not enough for the younger people in terms of jobs. And it's a sad situation. And a lot of my friends forgot to tell me that, oh, by the way, the water was contaminated water. Like, I'm like, how can you not tell me that? You're telling me that the place is booming and that I should move back, but you're not going to tell me about the water problem, which, by the way, is still ongoing. Apparently, Detroit's kind of, they're trying to offer Flint some solutions until they get connected to Port Huron. I was about to say, never mind. Anyway, who's leading? Anyway, I'm not going to even go there. But anyway, baby boomers. Speaking of housing, the housing market apparently is doing well. New startups actually increased by 6.5% in September, which is awesome. Really good number in September. Interesting enough, baby boomers. There's another article on Zero Hedge that was talking about baby boomers and the fact that they're being squeezed out of the market because a lot of these people, on average, pretty much save about $150,000 for their retirement. But then, the rent just goes higher and higher and higher. And on average, they're saving somewhere around $650 for rent. A big problem they're running into is that the rent just keeps going up. It recently went up by 5.7%, and Rent.com did a poll of about 500 property managers, and apparently they're planning on raising rent by another 8%. So that affects everybody, whether you're a baby boomer or not. So what happens when these people with fixed incomes get priced out of the market? Well, they end up in, they're pretty much forced to move out to certain areas. That they're not owning a house, they're in a rough situation because they may end up priced out of a certain area and forced to move into an area that's not as safe. And then there's other problems. It's sad. A lot of people just didn't save up enough. They spent too much when they were younger. A lot of people spent too much money on these college loans, on sending their kids to college. And a lot of these kids didn't really do much with it, which I think is a terrible thing to do. You know, to have your parents spend all that money on that, okay? All that money on that college, and you're not even going to finish college or do anything with the college. It's ridiculous. But anyway, and also the article was talking about how a lot of baby boomers are moving in with their kids now. It's interesting there. Most of these baby boomers are homeowners, and a lot of them probably have their own kids in their house right now, and that's creating a financial strain. But what would that be like to be married with kids and then your mom and father move in? I know in some cultures that's actually normal, and that's a normal part of life. But in this in our society, and a lot of our cultures, it's not really the standard thing to do. So that has to take a great deal of getting used to. So, you know, have you ever had to deal with a situation like that? I know there's some friends of mine back in Michigan who are living with their parents, or the parents are living with them, and it can create a lot of awkward situations. So share your story if you ever had a situation like that where you're living with your parents and you're married or have any kids. What are some of the challenges? What was that like? Just share your experiences. All right, guys, thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. And don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today. And thank you for your suggestions on what type of boots I should go with. I heard a lot of people say Danner boots. I heard a lot of people say Red Wings. It seemed to be really popular. I don't mind paying more. I just need it to last a longer amount of time. And it really depends on how I use it. But yeah, once again, I went over your comments. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.